Hello and welcome. I hope you're doing well. Get cozy as I share with you some absolutely terrifying Sasquatch encounters. Now, before I start, I want to let you know that on this channel, I like to share encounters that are more of a slow boil, that tend to create an atmosphere and a mood. If you're a fan of encounters like this, be sure to hit that subscribe button and turn on the notifications. I post new videos every Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday, and if you have your notifications on, you'll be the first to know when those videos go live. All right, let's get right into it. On the day I had my sighting, my girlfriends and I had decided to take a hike up to the fire lookout station atop Shadow Mountain. The hike began from the Grand Lake entrance area. We soon found ourselves wrapping around the lake with Shadow Mountain in full view. In hindsight, I would highly recommend wearing bug spray when walking near the lake. It was something that we did not have that day, and boy, did we pay for it. The mosquitoes were absolutely brutal. At times, as we were close to the water's edge, once we were clear of the area, we started heading directly towards the mountain itself and its ascending trail. By the time we were midway up the mountain trail, we had already seen a bear and several deer, as well as many chipmunks and what I believe was a mink, or something of the sort. Once you are beyond the midway point, the trail becomes quite steep. There were a lot of trees across the trail that day, which made things quite difficult for us. Nevertheless, we had made it to the top. We approached the lookout with relief, but were disappointed. To our dismay, the tower's staircase was locked, keeping us from climbing up onto it. Basically, it's a fairly short tower made from stone with painted brown logs forming a deck base up on the top, upon which a small hut-like structure is attached to it. So we sat up there for about an hour or two, enjoying the views from every side of the mountain. It was actually breathtaking, and I would highly recommend it to anyone with a good pair of legs. The trees in this area are predominantly some type of narrow-growing pines, which I believe are spruce. A fair amount of them are dead, which creates a type of screen to the eyes as you are peering about on the trail. We had actually seen bears and deer walking about in this timber screening as we were on our way up to the lookout station. It gave the appearance of something walking behind a stockade fence with every other slat removed. What I am trying to do here is to set the stage for you visually for what we were about to see on our descent from Shadow Mountain. The three of us had just passed the steepest section as we were making our way down the slope. It was right about that time when my girlfriend, Trisha, said, "Look, guys, there's another bear down there." As we all turned our heads to look, I think that Trisha realized at the same time that we all did that this wasn't a bear, but rather a Bigfoot. At first glance, this was an easy mistake to make because of the broken field of vision created by all of the dead gray trees. We were quite a bit higher than this creature that was walking through the trees down and away off to our right-hand side. We weren't making any noise other than walking. Otherwise, I am sure it would have spied us out, but it hadn't. This Bigfoot was on a mission because it didn't stop for a second as it was walking. When we first saw it, I believe we were maybe 300 or 400 feet away from it, and we were able to get some fairly good looks as it traversed the slope. The only way it could have seen us would have been to look up and over its left shoulder, which it thankfully didn't do. At the place we were on the trail, there was really nowhere to hide, so we just quietly stood our ground and watched. This thing was moving very quickly through the tightly packed pines, and we could see the treetops rocking back and forth as it parted them, making its way through, using its arms and hands to clear the path. I would say that most of the trees in here were between, say, 12 and 25 feet. The Bigfoot measured up as being pretty damn tall in our estimation. It was an incredible sight to behold, and no, it wasn't a man in a monkey suit. One of the most bothersome things about having a sighting like this is the after effect of how you are perceived by your peers, having told them of your experience. Speaking for myself, I was as high as a kite for weeks after the sighting and anxious to tell everyone and anyone about what I had seen. But those euphoric feelings soon dwindled away as I saw and heard the reactions of those with whom I spoke. It's really a crying shame that people choose to be so ignorant about these things. However, that's coming from someone's perspective who had just seen one. I'm not sure how I would have reacted had you told me of your experience, but I'd like to think that I would have responded in a better way than most. On to the next story. I was living in Arizona at the time of this story. In my mind, one of the most unlikely places to ever even think of Bigfoot, yet alone see one. It was in Prescott, so maybe there's enough forested area around there for them to live. But Bigfoot was a new concept for me, I can tell you that. We had a nice place on the edge of town, right in the Ponderosa Pines, with a big deck that went halfway around the house. It was a nice spot. My wife and I have since retired and moved back to Colorado, where we're originally from. Well, one day I was sitting on the deck when I spotted something out of the corner of my eye back in the trees. At the time, a cougar had been coming around, so I was pretty aware of movement. The cougar had actually dragged a dog from its yard, although the owner had managed to scare it off and rescue the dog, but just barely. So, I was just sitting there, drinking my morning coffee, thinking about some stuff at work. I was a college professor and half asleep when I saw this movement back in the trees. I'm not one to defy nature, so I got up and went inside. If it was a cougar, I wasn't taking any chances. I also wanted to grab my camera and see if I could get a good shot of one, if that's what it was. So I was running into the kitchen where I'd put my camera on the table, then running back around to the living room where I'd been sitting outside on the deck, when I saw something for sure running out the window. But it appeared to be running away from the house, only maybe 30 feet from the deck. Had it come up to the house? If so, how did it turn around and retreat that fast? I couldn't believe it. It looked like the tail end of something huge, but I only got a glimpse before it was back in the pines. It was dark brown, except for the bottoms of its feet, which, as it picked them up running, I could see were lighter in color. It had really wide shoulders, like someone wearing shoulder pads would have. I did have the presence of mind to take a photo, which I later showed to my daughter, who's a semi-pro photographer, and she was pretty shook up. Like all Bigfoot photos, it wasn't real definitive, just a black, blurry object. But given the story that it went with, it was proof enough for me. As this thing ran away, I was standing there in shock, and I could actually hear the timber breaking as it ran through, crushing branches and all. And man, it was as fast as a greased pig, which I've never seen, but I hear are fast. So I stood there for a bit. Then it dawned on me to go outside and see if there were any tracks or anything. I was scared to death, but it had obviously run away, so I figured I would just look around a bit and stay close to the house. Maybe I could get some good photos if there were prints. It would make people more likely to believe me. I'll be darned if I opened the door and almost stepped on something. I was shocked. It was a little kitten, maybe about 2 months old, huddled there, a gray and white long-haired tabby with the cutest little lynx-like face. I stood there for a minute, wondering where it had come from and why it didn't run away when I noticed it was twisted all weird. It then started meowing, this tiny little meow, and trying to stand up. It could pull itself up with its front paws, but its rear end just dragged along behind it. It was injured, and maybe pretty seriously. Oh geez, what the heck? Where did this little thing come from? Was there some relationship to this and what I swear looked like a Bigfoot? There had to be. It was no coincidence. And the kitten had to be carried and put there. No way could it move itself. I'd been sitting there just moments ago, so even if it did manage to drag itself up onto the porch, I would have noticed it. Did the Bigfoot injure it? Was it trying to get help for the kitten? I went inside and got a small towel and carefully kind of rolled the kitten onto the towel and then very gently wrapped it up and took it inside. I offered it some water and it was very thirsty. I didn't want to feed it, as I knew it would maybe need surgery right away, so I found a small box and made a little bed for it and headed for the car. The kitten stank to high heaven, a strong odor of skunk or something really rancid. As I went outside, that same odor floated through the air. I can tell you, this really gave me pause. Truthfully, I was scared to even walk out to my car. As I drove down the lane and out to the highway, I dialed my vet and told them I was on my way. Since I have two dogs, golden retrievers, both with my wife that day, I knew the vet. I quickly got the kitten there, where they examined it and said they needed to take x-rays to see what was wrong, but they suspected a broken pelvis. Okay by me, I would figure out the bill later. You can't let creatures suffer. It wasn't long until the vet came out into the waiting room and confirmed a broken pelvis. And on top of that, the little guy had a partially crushed hip joint. The vet said the pelvis couldn't be repaired, but it would heal naturally if we kept the kitten restricted, but they could repair the joint. The vet also wondered why the cat smelled so bad. Of course, I wasn't sure then, although I now know. I said goodbye to the little fellow and went home, knowing it was in capable hands, but before I left, they asked me what his name was, so I just off the cuff came up with Charlie. So Charlie it was. They did the surgery the next day, then called me in the afternoon to tell me Charlie was doing well, but they wanted to keep him for a few days and make sure he would be okay. In the meantime, my wife, Carrie, came home and I told her all about it. By then, I had loaded the photo of the Bigfoot onto my computer. She didn't like this story one bit, and I could tell she was both scared and incredulous. But I just didn't know what to say. Like most of my life, I was just a passenger on the bus. Carrie had gotten where she wouldn't let the dogs go outside without standing there watching them, even though we had a fenced yard, and I figured that was a good idea, given the cougar had tried to carry off a dog not too far away. But now, Carrie was even more nervous, and I have to admit, I was too. I made sure all the doors were locked, then had to kind of laugh at myself. What I'd seen leaving the yard, well, no lock on earth would stop that beast. That night, I swear, I could hear something talking to me, and it woke me up. I just lay there, really still and quiet, and I could hear it again, a voice, saying something in a language I didn't speak. It was coming from the deck, and it seemed like it was sad, although why I felt that, I have no idea. Shoot, was I terrified. Carrie was still asleep, but the dogs were under the bed, growling, but really quietly, like they didn't want anyone to know they were there. Like you would if you were hiding from a predator, and yet trying to be defensive. That confirmed that I wasn't dreaming. I lay there a bit, then decided I had to go see what it was. My family's safety was my responsibility. I'm not a hunter, so I didn't have any kind of weapons, but I went anyways. Maybe I did it for my own sanity, I don't know. I didn't turn on any of the lights, just very softly crept into the living room, keeping along near the wall where I could sort of sneak up to the window and look out into the dark. Believe me, I felt nothing like a hero, which is what you're supposed to be when you do something brave while you're scared to death. I felt more like a fool. The dogs, brave as they are, stayed under the bed. I very quietly looked out onto the deck, but there was nothing there. The voice was gone, and I was beginning to think it was all a dream, but I could feel my own hand shaking. I finally got the courage to turn on the deck lights, and that's when I saw it. Something was on the deck. It kind of looked like a basket. My first thought was, oh no, not another kitten. I knew it was utterly stupid to open the door and go out there, but I had to see what it was. Maybe it was some kind of bait, and I would be a goner as soon as I stepped out, but I went anyway. The first thing I noticed was that smell again. It was so powerful, it nearly knocked me over. I slowly stepped out to where the basket thing was and picked it up, expecting to be attacked by something, but wasn't. I didn't want to take it inside, as it really stank, but I wanted to see it better, so I stepped into the living room and turned on the light. It was indeed a basket, and though a rough one, made perhaps by large hands that couldn't really do fine work, it looked like it was made from dried sumac, and inside was a dead fish, smelly dead fish, maybe a small carp? The combination of the dead fish and the skunky smell almost made me throw up. Now, Carrie was coming into the living room, asking what was going on. I didn't say a word, and when she saw the basket and the dead fish, she got really quiet. "Let's put it in the basement for now," she said, "where we can't smell it. Wrap it in plastic." "Why not back outside?" I asked. "It's a gift. We don't want to refuse it," she answered. "A gift?" "From the Bigfoot." Needless to say, neither of us got any sleep. We sat in the dark and listened for weird noises, scared to death. But we also talked about the whole situation. Why did the Bigfoot bring the kitten to us? Carrie was convinced it was being a good Samaritan and saving it. I wasn't so sure. I know I just wanted to go get a motel room and never come back, at least not at night. This whole thing was getting really weird. The next day, I called the vet to check on Charlie. He was doing great, but of course, it was too soon for him to come home. I then asked what they thought would cause an injury like that. Had Charlie possibly been manhandled by something big? I think the vet thought my question was a bit strange, but he answered that it was without a doubt caused by getting run over. A car had run over Charlie. It was a very common injury when cars and cats met. I pondered this a bit and shared it with Carrie when she got home from work. She was now even more convinced Bigfoot had found Charlie and brought him to us for help, then brought us a gift in thanks. I found it hard to believe we were even having that conversation. I pride myself on having a scientific bent. A few days ago, neither of us even believed in Bigfoot, especially not one out in Arizona. And now we were talking about Bigfoot Samaritans? How quickly things change. The next night, all was quiet. Although, at one point, I heard the dogs growling, but only for a moment. Carrie and I kind of huddled together all night long, neither of us getting much sleep. We were terrified, and our house was no longer our refuge. I was actually wishing I'd seen a cougar instead of a Bigfoot. The next day, I went to the university, and Carrie went to work, leaving the dogs locked in the house for the day. The doggy door closed. I ran home between classes and let them out. Finally, the next day, it was time for Charlie to come home. My wife had bought a small cat carrier and picked him up after work, as I was too busy. I hated to see what the vet bill was, but it actually was pretty reasonable, and Charlie's prognosis was good. Since he was so young, he would heal fine, but we had to keep him contained for several months so his pelvis could heal. He could hang around the house with us, but for short stretches only at first, and the rest of the time he was to be in this big metal carrier they loaned us. Carrie set the carrier up in the living room where Charlie could see us and be part of the family. We fed him and took turns holding him while the little guy purred. He sure was cute, but when we left him for the night, he meowed and meowed. I wanted to bring him into the bedroom, but the dogs wouldn't leave him alone. They kept trying to sniff him, scaring him, so we left him in the living room. He finally settled down. That night, someone or something tried to break into the house. The door into the living room was pushed open, breaking the lock. The dogs at first went ballistic. Then they bravely headed for refuge under the bed. Carrie and I both ran out into the living room, and we must have scared off whatever it was. We called the sheriff, and I thought about our actions later, and we must have lost our minds, as a burglar could have easily shot us. I guess we both were thinking about animals getting in, like a cougar, and were brave because of Charlie. We didn't want anything to happen to him. We moved him into our bedroom after that. Two deputies showed up and checked everything out, but found nothing. They both remarked on a strong smell outside. They took photos, looked around a bush, then eventually left. I asked Carrie why didn't they fingerprint the broken doorknob. Her reply was, it was a good thing they didn't, as they wouldn't know how to deal with Bigfoot fingerprints. Carrie had a theory that the Bigfoot was checking in to see what had happened to Charlie, but I thought maybe he had come back to get him. Either way was bad. We sure didn't need a Bigfoot coming around, gift or no gift. In the meantime, my daughter, the photographer, had developed an interest in Bigfoot and had done a lot of research and reading on the internet about other people's sightings and experience. She said all we needed to do to keep it away was to put up a game cam or some kind of surveillance camera, and we would never see it again. I thought this was kind of funny, but I did go and get one. It didn't stop one bit. But later, my daughter said I had failed to hook it up to a recording device, so no Bigfoot video. Carrie said we needed to show the Bigfoot somehow that Charlie was fine, and then it would go away. Maybe it had heard the kitten meowing that night and was worried. I was beginning to wonder how she had developed such an insight into these creatures, but maybe it was a woman's intuition. So we took to sitting on the deck, holding Charlie, and letting him drag himself around a bit each evening, as the vet said this would help him develop his muscles, and I swear, if more than once I didn't get the feeling that we were being watched, it made my hands go clammy. I was actually toying with the idea of selling the house and moving into town, though I didn't mention it to Carrie. I found out later she was thinking the same thing, but after that the beast didn't try to break into the house again, although it did continue to leave gifts on the deck. rocks and sticks and another dead fish. Eventually, Charlie recovered, and he's now the magnificent and most gorgeous cat who rules the roost, including the dogs, though Goldens are pretty easy to rule over as they're so mellow. We spent many hours out on the deck, and then the yard, rehabilitating Charlie, and I know the Bigfoot was there for some of that time, watching from the forest. I could always tell, as I would get this strange feeling of being watched. It always gave me the creeps, and I never got used to it. I was always scared to death of that thing. As Charlie recovered, the Bigfoot visits became less frequent until the creature finally quit coming around. We not too long thereafter retired and moved to Colorado, getting a place in town with a big yard where Charlie can play all he wants. But while we were in Prescott, Charlie was never allowed outside alone. It was too dangerous, with cougars, coyotes, and, well, I almost said Bigfoot, but I guess that would be wrong, since that particular Bigfoot saved Charlie's life. Thanks, Mr. Bigfoot, wherever you are. You are a true good Samaritan. And the basket? It never lost its odor, so we eventually threw it away. Carrie took it to a dumpster in town as she didn't want the Bigfoot to know and thus hurt its feelings. But now we both wish we'd kept it. How often does one get a sumac Bigfoot basket? I hope you enjoyed those stories, and if you did, be sure to hit that subscribe button and the notification bell. I post new videos every Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday, and if you have your notifications on, you'll be the first to know when those go live. Again, thank you so much for watching the video, and until next time, bye!